of June 1934 passed into history as the Night of the Long Knives. Hundreds were seized and summarily executed. The scale and ferocity of the action stunned the public, although bringing also a widespread sense of relief. The unflinching readiness with which the well-disciplined SS struck down their erstwhile comrades impressed and gratified Hitler. During the following year, 1935, Goering was happily installed as commander of the new German Air Force, and the Gestapo in its entirety was absorbed into Himmler's SS fiefdom. Calm and order returned to the streets. Between a crash program of public works and a covert but large-scale program of rearmament, unemployment disappeared. Spectacular, magnificently staged managed parades and rallies convincingly presented the image of a contented, prosperous people, enthusiastically united behind the leader. The reality was otherwise. At the Great Rally of 1935, the first of the infamous Nuremberg laws against those of Jewish blood were promulgated. Over the years, more than 200 further decrees would be announced, designed to eradicate every taint of Jewishness from German life. But the secret apparatus of terror would reach out not to Jews only, but to every German citizen. And it was expanding fast. By 1936, Himmler had achieved his long striven for goal of undivided command of all Germany's police forces, secret or uniformed. The Gestapo gained immunity from any challenge in the law courts. In future, any appeal against the Gestapo's action could only be heard by the Gestapo itself. As operational head of the Gestapo, though reporting to Heydrich, Himmler had appointed Heinrich Mohrer. This Bavarian expert on surveillance and political police work would remain in office until the very end. Mohrer had visited the Soviet Union, where he'd been impressed by the method of Stalin's secret police, and particularly by the all-pervading system of informers. Under Mohrer, Gestapo recruitment was accelerated. Eventually, its agents numbered many tens of thousands. And soon, there was no street or block of flats, no office or workplace where the eyes and ears of the Gestapo did not reach. Usually, the informers were unpaid, but they enjoyed the heady sense of power over their fellow men. The realization spread that a denunciation to the Gestapo was often an effective method of settling a personal grudge or of opening the way to a promotion. Even children were, all unconsciously, brought in to serve the cause. The various National Socialist youth movements enjoyed immense popularity, whilst insidiously and persistently inculcating a loyalty beyond that of the family. Parents could no longer be sure they were not being spied on by their own offspring. In the summer of 1936, the Olympic Games were held in Berlin. And since Hitler wanted Germany to show an acceptable face to the world, the persecution of the Jews was temporarily eased. Nor did Hitler wish to be seen tampering directly with the German churches. Instead, many clerics were subjected to personal intimidation and to smear campaigns conducted through the state-controlled press. Though keeping wherever possible outside the public eye, the leather-coated Gestapo officials waged a relentless war on dissidents. Over 250 members of a workers' resistance group in Stettin were arrested and jailed for circulating banned newspapers and for holding private meetings. Later, prominent visitors to Berlin were encouraged to patronize the Salon Kitty, a nightclub covertly run by the Gestapo. Amongst the discreet services on offer were concealed microphones in every bedroom. Year by year, the Gestapo files expanded. They abounded with compromising information of every kind. Adroitly used, almost anyone could be incriminated. In early 1938, Blumberg and Fritsch, respectively War Minister and Army Commander-in-Chief, were forced out of office as a consequence of scandals fabricated using Gestapo material. By 1938, Hitler felt ready to embark upon the process of winning new lands for the Reich. His first step was the Anschluss, the absorption of Austria into an enlarged Greater Germany. Hitler's triumphal entry into his new dominions was attended by extravagant demonstrations of public rejoicing. But behind the scenes, well hidden from general view, the Gestapo and SS were busy disposing of the remnants of Austria's political opposition. Following the Anschluss, even more Jews were desperate to escape Hitler's oppression. The Gestapo opened an office in Vienna, which enjoyed a monopoly in the issuing of exit visas to Jews. This profitable enterprise was run by an Austrian SS officer, Karl Adolf Eichmann. Himmler made a tour of Vienna and its environs and fixed upon the picturesque village of Mauthausen as a site for a new concentration camp. After Austria, Hitler's attention focused next on Czechoslovakia, where there lived 3 million Sudeten Germans. Many believed that any attempt of Hitler's to seize the Sudetenland would lead to a general European war. If so, Heydrich was resolved to take sinister advantage of the situation. That summer, intense diplomatic maneuvering took place in Europe's capitals. Simultaneously, in deepest secrecy, Heydrich brought together Gestapo and other units to form what were termed special purpose groups. These would follow the German army into Czechoslovakia. Their function would be to deal with the Jews. Their method would be mass execution. Heydrich's plans were forestalled when, at the Munich conference in October, Britain and France capitulated in the face of Hitler's aggressive posturing and boldly calculated bluff. Czechoslovakia was abandoned by her allies in exchange for a worthless promise. Hitler gained the lands he'd coveted without a shot having been fired. Nevertheless, the special purpose groups remained in being. In the spring of 1939, German forces occupied Bohemia and Moravia, and the dismemberment of Czechoslovakia was completed. In London and Paris, the occupation was received as shocking confirmation of the emptiness of Hitler's pledged word. So far, an inspired blend of bluff and intimidation had served Hitler well, but he knew that his next objective, the annexation of large tracts of Polish territory, could not be achieved save through the force of arms. In August, the way was made clear by a non-aggression treaty with Stalin's Soviet Union. As the German armies prepared for invasion, Hitler cast around for a pretext for war. Müller offered to supply some Gestapo prisoners for a mock attack on a German radio station at Gleiwitz, near the border. The intention was that listeners would hear what sounded like a Polish assault. For added authenticity, Müller's prisoners, dressed in Polish uniforms, would be taken to the scene and shot. Though few of the pleasure seekers in the capital can have known it, the evening of September the 2nd, 1939, was Berlin's last night of peace. Heydrich sat listening expectantly to his wireless. But no one had thought to check the strength of the Gleiwitz transmitter. Its signal faded after a few kilometers, and Europe heard nothing of the studiously rehearsed affray. Some photographs were published in newspapers the next day, but by then, German forces were thrusting deep into Poland. That stricken country was soon under attack on two fronts, for by a secret protocol to the pact with Stalin, the Soviet Union was to receive a share of Polish territory, and the Red Army marched in from the east. German